Good morning. We would like to welcome you all to the worship service of the Northwest Region of the Johannesburg Church of Christ. I would like to welcome you all here in the building, and we also welcome you for those who are joining us online. My name is Selepe Petla, and if you are visiting with us for the first time, you are truly our honors guest. With me is my lovely fiancé. I'm a blessed man. With me is my lovely fiancé, Yandisa.
Good morning, church. It's great to have you all here this morning. We're looking forward to worshiping with you, sharing in communion, and hearing God's word. Today we have our special guests joining us from the USA, St. Louis, Bill and Kristin Moulden. To the Mouldens, we're so pleased to have you with us. Thank you so much for an incredible time yesterday at the singles workshop, the shift workshop. We were challenged and we learned so much, and we're looking forward to learning more today. As we're about to start our worship service, I'd like for us to reflect on a scripture from Psalm 95, verse 1 to 9. Come, let us sing to joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and exalt him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods.
Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord Almighty, we humbly come before you this morning. We thank you that, Father God, you allowed us to see this day. We thank you, Father, that you allowed us to come and have fellowship with you and have fellowship with one another and with the Holy Spirit, mighty God. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that although it's cold, but we also can be able to see the sun, mighty God. Father, at this moment, I pray for our brothers and sisters and everyone who's in KZN right now, God, where there's heavy rain pelting through the city and the province. I pray that you may protect them. I pray, Father God, that no lives will be lost. And I pray that, Father God, will reach out to them and help where we are able to be. We can help them, mighty God. Father God, be with our worship service today. Be with those who will be leading us in song. Father God, I pray we'll worship you with glad and sincere hearts, mighty God. Be with Bill and Kristin as they'll be sharing your word and communion with us later on, God, that you may fill them with your spirit and help them, Father God, as they teach us, that, Father God, our hearts will be open and receptive to your message, mighty God. God, we love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. Please join us as we shout to our God, the great King. Shout to the Lord.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your life. nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, shout to the Lord of the earth, let us see power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
Nothing compares.
Nothing compares to the promise I have.
Nothing compares.
Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. In you.
Amen.
Amen, church. I just want to encourage us all to worship in whichever way you feel called to worship.
Mm-hmm. Lord bless you. His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Gracious to you, the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Let's sing Amen.
Lord, upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children.
Thank you, God, for your love.
Yeah.
praise.
Good morning. Great to be together this morning. Fantastic to see so many people here at the building. And of course, all those at home, welcome to our worship service. Just a couple of announcements. But I must say, worship team, thank you so much for encouraging us and helping us worship God. Fantastic job. Thank you for always being here early and leaving late and preparing during the week. We really appreciate your effort. A couple of announcements. First of all, this week we'll have midweek on Thursday night, and that's not just our normal midweek for the marriage. It's also for the singles and the campus and the teens and just all of creation, okay? So it will be on Zoom for your own comfort, and we will have, I'll introduce them in a little bit here, but Dr. Bill Moulden will be our guest speaker, and who knows what the topic might be. Come on Thursday night at 7:30, and you will be amazed. Okay, then of course, we've just finished our series on... not money, Making change, okay? And what was the four topics? I'm so glad we learned so much in the last month. So what we want to do, I know the office have sent everybody a link to fill out your pledges for the year. So please, your monthly pledge or weekly pledge, however you pledge, and then also your special contribution. Please, guys, we need everybody's to be filled in, and so we can make plans for the next year or so. Then, of course, this year, for the first time in 2 years, we're going to have a kids camp swamp camp at the end of the year. And our preteens are making creative ways or creative plans to raise some money for their camp fees. So they'll be selling all kinds of snacky things, not sneaky, snacky things, to raise funds for their camp after church, as well as doing the parenting workshop next week. So they're going to be here next Saturday. I hope you will be here as well. Please support our preteens. Okay, then of course our MTA is coming up and our parenting workshop next Saturday. Please take note of some important details for the up-and-coming MTA class on marriage and family and parenting. If you are attending, you need to register. Okay, so even if you come the Saturday afternoon for free, please, you need to register just so we know how many people are going to be here. So do we set up in the chapel? Do we set up in a kids zone little classroom? Or do we open up this hall for everybody? Okay. We don't want to be surprised. Just surprise us by registering. Okay. Please select one of the three options. So of course you can choose. Number one is the free option. If you just come in the afternoon on Saturday from 1:30 till 5:00. So the first class will start at 1:30. You would have had a nice light lunch, so you don't fall asleep in the class until 5 o'clock. Number two, non-grading students, 150 Rand, where even if you're not going to attend the marriage classes on the Friday on Zoom, you can still listen to all the classes on Friday. You'll have access to the marriage classes on the link will be sent to you, and those are three different marriage classes on previous weeks, the 4th, the 11th, and the 18th. And then, of course, for those who are serious students, that cost is 500 Rand for the grading guys, and I'm sure you know by now how all of that works. Then our campus students, again, for the first time in 2 years because of COVID, you're going to have your campus encounter. Okay, so this is going to be a great event. Dates is the 15th to the 17th of July, Friday night all the way to Saturday after lunch. The venue is not the normal venue, but the Youth for Christ Center in Hackpoort. That's to the west of us. Price, 1,250 Rand per person. That includes your accommodation, 6 catered meals, a T-shirt, bus transport from the church building if you need that. All you need to bring is yourself, your friends, zeal, a desire to learn and grow, your own bedding. It gets pretty cold out there. It is winter. Yeah? We will be sending the registration link and instructions soon. You can speak to Jock and Laura about that. Okay, so our last announcement, we're going to play the latest Hot News Kidogo clip, and this is from our sister church in Brazil. And then, so if I can ask the song leaders to come up, we'll have one more song after the video, and then I'll introduce you to our guest speakers this morning. Enjoy the video.
I'm David Florent, and we're part of the International Churches of Christ. Today, we head for Brazil. This year in Brazil, there have been some unifying and milestone events. In January 2022, Brazil hosted their first Sao Paulo church camp. 136 campers attended. In February, there was a virtual women's leadership meeting, including women from all 13 Brazilian churches for the first time ever. 230 women participated, and the women left feeling united in the faith across the country more than ever before. The youth ministry has been growing in our Church of 200 in Belo Horizonte. In 2021, they had an incredible youth ministry retreat. and Rafaela, Isabelle, and the following week, Amanda, were baptized. The youth have strengthened and inspired our church in Belo Horizonte, and there are more teens currently studying the Bible. Thanks for joining us, and God bless.
Wow. I've now figured out why the song leaders actually put a mic in front of me in the mornings. They've realized they're losing out on some talent down there. I'm sure they've cut off. You can't even switch on that mic, I think.
I can see some of the teens are already moving out, but just if you, preteens, if I can ask you, if you forgot, your class will start outside in the boardroom, actually. So this morning, I am truly honored to introduce to you our guest speakers. And in the last couple of days, we've been trying to teach them how load shedding works. And then he mispronounced it as load shifting. And then we realized maybe he's right because it keeps on shifting. Every time they give us a schedule, it changes. So he's actually right. It's not load shedding, it's load shifting, led by the Spirit. It's been a tremendous privilege to have them in Joburg. And Dr. Bill and Kristin Moulden has served in the full-time ministry for almost 30 years. They've served throughout the Southwest and Midwest, and now the Heartland family of churches, wherever that might be, somewhere in the middle of the U.S.
Yeah, there we go.
They currently serve as an evangelist and teacher, and she as a woman ministry leader with the Gateway City Church in St. Louis. As singles, Bill and Kristin actually met on a mission team. That's where you meet a spiritual spouse. They now have been married for 26 years, have three beautiful daughters. Two of them are here. Maybe you guys can stand. You met the third one a couple of weeks ago. She came here, and Emily, and we got to know her. She's back at home. And who knows, the next time they come, they're probably immigrating. Not sure where that came from, but must be the Spirit is moving this morning. So Bill has also he's not just a teacher and not just an evangelist. He has a master's degree in divinity and a doctorate in ministry from the Trinity Southwest University. Now, if your husband does all of that extra work and studying, you must understand there's a phenomenal woman behind the scenes who made all of that possible, right? So we want to welcome the Mouldens. Why don't you guys stand? Of course, the singles met them yesterday, had a fantastic time yesterday, had a great party last night. And so today, we are so grateful to have these guys. Let's open our hearts and our minds and our ears and our cell phones to open on the Bible app. Welcome.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Amen. I'm going to hand this to you, babe. Am I on? All right. Awesome. Awesome. Well, greetings, church. We get it. We get why when Gwendolyn set foot into this congregation, she immediately fell in love. I now understand that my need to surrender her has grown greater and greater with every passing day, with every one of you I've met. I go, I'm never going to get her back. I'm trying not to have an attitude. But you guys are amazing. And Kristin and I are so grateful to be here with you. We had such an amazing time with your singles. We will take back that spirit of celebration over anything. That was such a great demonstration of just kind of the spirit of the whole country, maybe the spirit of this church especially. We just wanted to do a group picture. That's all we wanted. We just wanted people to gather around. We take a group picture, and what happens was 10 minutes of praise. And dancing. And I learned new steps to beats I have never heard before. It was amazing. And I thought, you guys get it. You have to make the most of every opportunity. That's what Paul tells us. We need to celebrate things because everything in this world is trying to beat us down. And that's why this morning, Kristin and I are so excited to kind of share this sermunion that will lead us into communion, but we're excited to talk about a shift that we all need to make. You know, because we're existing in a world, but a lot of times we're not really sure how we are to exist. And yet Jesus came and says, we should always do things in a cross-shaped way. There is a word for that that I want to introduce to you today, and that is the word cruciformity, being cross-shaped. Because when we approach life in a cross-shaped way, even when we go through hard things, God finds a way to bring redemption and growth and change out of them. And I'm going to have Kristin share with you guys right now.
Amen. It's awesome to be here, South Africa. Thank you for having us. It's been quite amazing since we've been here. Your beautiful country. It's amazing people, culture. It's wonderful. I'm getting the opportunity to share my testimony again, but recently. So I wanted to start with before I was baptized. It was 12 midnight on May 22nd, 1991. So I turned 31 yesterday. 31. The sky was clear and dark and beautiful in Southern California. You should all visit. It's wonderful. The jacuzzi where I was baptized was on a hill. I remember walking 2 flights of stairs, and as I climbed, the only thing I could see was light coming from the jacuzzi because it was midnight. I was like, wow, God's ushering me into heaven, because it's just the lights going straight up. Woo. I felt so loved. She helped me start. And on that day, Jesus embraced me to be his daughter. You know, I felt like he said to me, I'm giving you the right to become a child of God. Jesus embraced me that night, and, you know, he looked at me with the eyes of love, and today, really, you must be put to death. And surrender all of you to me. But do not worry, I will be with you there on the cross. You will need to be buried through the waters of baptism, and there I will wash you in my blood and take the sins that lead to darkness, so that they will not result in death. Sorry. I am a crier. So I cry when I'm happy, I cry when I'm sad. You know, and that day he gave me the gift of the Holy Spirit, and I rose with him in victory out of the water. He gave me a new name, his name, which is awesome.
Amen.
A new purpose in life. And I was now to become a witness to his light. Ooh. So on that day, he reassured me. And I thought to myself, there's nobody like him. Nobody like Jesus. Fast forward 31 years, 29 years in the ministry, 3 awesome children later, 6 dogs later. You know, again, he is reconverting me, re-bringing me through the baptism. In Luke 22, verse 31, the Bible says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. You know, sifting is a 2-part process, right? You gather the wheat, you throw it on the floor, and you start beating it with a stick over and over and over so the husks fall to the ground. And then you take it, and you throw it in the air, and then the husks fall, and you get a perfect, usable wheat, the good wheat. You know, about 3 years ago, we were about to move from Chicago to St. Louis, Missouri, and we put our house on the market. Like I'm sure a lot of you sell your houses. And it was an amazing offer. And actually, Bill and I literally fell to the ground because we were like, God, thank you for answering our prayers. Like, thank you for your mercy. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Like, we cannot believe that we sold our house so quickly. We were blown away. At the same time we were getting ready to move, my back started hurting. And it was probably the worst pain of my life, and I have had 3 children. So the pain was, maybe some of you can relate to, it was crippling and consuming, and I couldn't sit at all. So I would go to church. I just laid. I could never sit. Laying in the back of the church. 3 weeks before we moved, I did have spine surgery, which was amazing. Not fun, but amazing. So now we have a contract with our house in Chicago. We have a contract with our house in St. Louis. So that was all good. But the minute we got into town, all the contracts fell apart. So now we have nowhere to live, and we just moved. We just drove there, and now we have no place to live. And a really sweet couple let us stay in one of her empty apartments, which was very kind. But we couldn't pay them because all of our money was going to Chicago, to the house there. And unfortunately, it really was, St. Louis has wonderful places, but it is a violent city. So we ended up in one of the second worst neighborhoods in St. Louis. It was dangerous. While we were there, we had two sets of bullets come through our apartment building. We could hear gunfire at night, which is always unnerving in the alleys.
Yeah.
Just kind of waiting like, oh, okay, duck, you know. So it's kind of intense there. You know, in a few months, we were still in the apartment, and I turned over in my bed, and all the things that they fixed on my back re-herniated. So this only happens to 1% of people, and I'm number one over
here. She's one in a million, guys.
I'm number one. And this time it was five times as painful as it was in the beginning. So I'm not a screamer. I was screaming for days in pain. I ended up in the hospital. Lost function of my bladder, which is always exciting, which caused nerve damage. So I left the hospital in a walker, which is like, how old am I, 100? You know, you're just feeling like, okay, this is a lot. And then, of course, the house still did not sell. And so it kind of wiped us out financially, all of our savings. So, you know, you kind of begin to ask God, like, what are you doing? You know, I don't know why I'm so emotional. Like, are you mad at me? And I don't know if you ever felt that way. Like, what did I do? Do I need to repent? Like, I kept coming up with things that I needed to do. And I began to kind of mistrust.
Yeah.
Just, you know, and some of you older Christians are like, haven't I given my whole life to you? You know, things start falling apart. And you kind of lose control of your life. You know, I kept thinking to myself, and this is for real, we had 500 people praying for us on a daily basis. And for my back, for that sell of our house, so we could actually come into St. Louis properly. So I really thought to myself, God is hearing me. God is hearing them. He is not ignoring what
That's
they're
right.
saying. And so I began to think, you know, he's doing something different. He's doing something different. And then all of the 505 people who were praying. So I began to embrace that. I began to embrace the fact that he was doing something different. And everyone kept saying to me, Kristin, you know, when this thing is all over and your back is better, you know, things are going to be really great. He's going to give you the best house and this and that. And I kept thinking to myself, but what if he doesn't? But in a healthy way, what if he doesn't? And I really wanted to be like the heroes of Daniel. You know, where it says, if you are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it. And he will rescue us from the hand, O King. But even if he doesn't, we want you to know, Amen. O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up, even if he doesn't answer. You know, and this was a time where God kind of began to say, Kristin, I need you to take the hand of pain, take my hand of fear, or whatever you're experiencing, and I need you to walk with me with them. And, so it's great, because it will help us on our way to heaven.
That's right.
I'm not looking this way. My girls are over there. You know, Jesus was praying for me that my faith wouldn't fail. You know, he taught, and then during this time I also was really taught that God is an amazing harvester. You know, see how the farmer waits for the land to yield a valuable crop, patiently waiting in autumn and spring, and be patient and stand firm. You know, our nature is to take when it's not ripe. We really want to just have it right then because we're praying for it. But God, that's not God's nature to give us something that's not mature.
That's right.
And, you know, he knows when we are ripe to not only receive the blessing, but for his glory and our profit. Like, he waits for that. He waits until we are ready, which is amazing. And I learned, like, it's okay to wait with him. It's okay to... And then I was also learning that the giver is more than the gift. Oh, thank you. I'll probably be fine by the end of this. But he knows that we are spiritually ready to receive to our profit and his glory. The giver is more than the gift is another thing I learned. And God is more than the blessing. And, you know, our waiting on him is the only way to find life and joy in himself. His waiting is the highest proof of his graciousness to us. God proves to be good to the man who patiently waits, to the woman who diligently seeks. It is a good thing to quietly hope for help for God. You know, Satan tries to shift all of us, even the good, right? But Jesus prays for us, which is so comforting, that our faith today will not fail, but be encouraged. You know, and we can all turn back as we're shifted through our life. And I did that at this point. And like Peter, I pray that this has strengthened you somehow. Sorry, throw out the tears. That it brings you closer somehow to the cross.
Amen. Great job. Making the shift. You know, there is only one way that you can really change your life. We know that when we come to salvation, we come in contact with a God who came to earth and lived as you and I do, lived perfectly, died, then rose again, and then went back to heaven victorious. And if that was the only part that he wanted to do, that would move us. But he did something more. He decided that not only am I going to do this, this is just to show you the pattern that we are to follow, but the shifts that you're going to make in your life, those changes, where you go from doing it all on your own strength into doing it in something more supernatural, more spirit-filled, more elevated because you're being fueled by something other than your best effort. It can only come by coming in contact with the cross over and over again and embracing a lifestyle that is cross-shaped. And no one had to struggle with this more than the Apostle Paul. Can we go to our presentation? Some things will always cause you to pray harder. Here are three are mine. I had thick, raven-like hair. I was a good-looking man at one time. Long, flowing locks and then one birth right after the other. It just all fell as I was bringing girls into the world. I was raised without a mom. I had no fit. My dad was awesome, single dad, raised me as a guy. You know what I'm talking about? Vegetables? What's that? Oh, those are the things that come out of a can that we're not going to eat. And God, in his great sense of humor, says, I know exactly what he needs. He needs to make a shift. I don't remember ever crying before I had girls. And then when I had girls, Disney films started the floodgates. They'll change you. They'll change you. They'll show you a side of God that you didn't know was lacking. They'll show you a side of prayer that you didn't know you needed. But those are the easy shifts. Paul dealt with life in a completely different manner. He was raised in the great tradition of the Pharisees. He was one that excelled in such a high degree that he was one of the star pupils of the great Rabbi Gamaliel. He was a star pupil so much that even outside of the Bible, Saul of Tarsus is mentioned in the rabbinic writings. He was one known as having an impudence of learning, which means he was obnoxiously annoying to his teacher. Hey, what else can I read? What else can I read? There is one story where Gamaliel laments, "I just simply didn't have enough books." That was our hero. That was Saul of Tarsus. He was not a man that when it came to repentance, he was a professional. He did everything he could to make himself look like he was in right standing with God. He was one that devoted his life that when he later writes as a Christian, that as far as in regards to the law, I was perfect. Not a one of us could say that. And yet, not a one of us was probably more lost and struggled more in his Christianity than Paul. He had to make shifts and be reconverted so many times, and you see it in his writings. But today I'm going to talk about the influence of even when you're trying your best, what happens when you start to embrace the cross. Can we go to our next slide? You know, to Paul, being a professional religious person, he knew very well that there are certain things you have to die to. You know, I love in Romans 6 that the old self has been crucified. I love that passage. Paul knew that just like when Jesus said you have to deny yourself and take up your cross, Paul knew in his training, but that in order for you to embrace God's will, there has to be a surrendering of yourself. And not just a surrendering, a dying to. That self needs to be crucified. And what did he mean by that self? He meant that thing that just drives you, your appetites, the things that you want, the things that you say, I don't care what happens, I'm going to take this for me. Paul goes, no, that kind of impulse needs to come under the authority of a Lord. It must die. The old self must die. Can I have my slide back up there again? Those are my sermon notes, so quit taking it away from me. Okay. But in this shifts, we kind of have this as a picture of the shifts that you need to make. Because spiritually, you can be in park. And that's when you're focused on yourself. And when you're in park, you're not going anywhere, right? We've kind of feel like we've been in park because of COVID for a while. I'm not talking about being righteously obedient to the mandates that are coming. That's why you're not going out. I'm talking about that spiritual place where the self has creeped back in. And now you're not really sure, what do I really need to surrender? How much discomfort do I really need to give? How much more out of myself do I really need to be? Once again, we can find these things creeping back in, and it's why we always have to go back to the scriptures that call us and remind us that, hey, we have to die to self. Because if we don't, then we go to the next gear, which is reverse, going in the opposite direction, and that's sin. We have to die to sin. Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Paul was so adamant. He was so shocked at how easily we allow sin to come in. Now, granted, he was a Pharisee. He has been battling the outward sins all of his life. But when he came into a Christian community, and I'm not talking Gentile and versus a Jew, I'm talking about the Christian community that all of a sudden started just making it so wishy-washy and so easy to allow sin to creep in, and it, things that are absolutely true of God becoming matters of opinion. I know this church doesn't struggle with any of this, but I'm talking about your brothers and sisters in the States. You know, those guys, not you, you're good. Sheep, goats, okay? Let's just go there. No, but But you know how it is, guys. Come on, where sin starts creeping in and you start to go, did God really say? And you're going, wait, I've heard that line before. Where was that? Oh, that was in Genesis. Did God really mean? And here Paul goes, guys, the reason why the Lord records scripture that deals with sin so much, it's not because it's a one and done deal. It's something we always have to check. The great news is that you could also repent. That there is no shame in coming to the understanding that, man, I've let some things slide. All there is a need to go back and put it to death. The one that I think affects us most is that third gear. We don't use it very often, except maybe when we're out of gas. You know that gear that is just neutral? And you kind of go into that gear. You know, we had a situation where someone was in neutral. They had run out of gas in the middle of an intersection. I needed to get out and push because that little guy wasn't going to get that big truck out of the intersection anytime soon. It seemed like a very selfless act, but I was like, man, we are going to dinner. So I got out and helped push. So anyway, just being totally someone thought I was like Jesus. I wasn't. I was hungry, and he was in neutral. He was in neutral, so we did that. You know, but it's this idea that neutral is the world that's just kind of drifting along. It's not putting anything into it. It's just kind of letting whatever comes our way kind of become the standard by which we live. It's the thing that just kind of, that comes into our lives and just kind of moves us along. Paul talks about it all over the place in Colossians 2 and Galatians 6:14. He just says, you have to die to the world. You have to be aware of its influence. You have to have your radar up and say, am I just drifting along? You know, the Hebrew writer would say that, right? We must be careful, parareo in Greek, that we do not just sort of drift. It's even kind of a drifting word, parareo. It's so easy. And I love that the Hebrew writer says, we must pay careful attention. We need the cross over and over again. But the one I think for Paul, if we can get the slide back up, that I think is really important is this last one that is going to come out of our main text for this morning. And that's out of Galatians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20. It's dying to the law. Can we go to the next slide? And the text says this, for through the law, I died to the law, so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Through the law, I died to the law. Nothing on earth exposed Paul like the fact, but by the knowledge that he had of every law and what every law meant. He would go on in Romans 7 to say, you know, it's that law that told me what coveting is. And once I realized what coveting was, I became an expert at coveting. Although no one saw it. And you kind of think of the brilliance of Paul to pick that one, because that's the one thing in the Big Ten, you know, the Ten Commandments that you can't see. And Paul goes, see, that's where we live, Christians. We live in that image protection, that image management. And you know how it goes. I mean, social media has trained us, right? You know, we now know the best camera angles. You know, we know the right filters. And, you know, I mean, how many people have adjusted their Zoom filter? Come on, you are all lying in Christ right now. There we go. You and me, we're the only ones. I'm a little bit rounder and smoother. I don't believe y'all. I just don't believe you. I know it's not good for a visiting preacher to say, I don't believe you, but I don't believe you. And some are like, wait, Zoom has filters? Oh, let me teach you the ways of the world. Wait, no, wrong sermon. But we are so good at image management. And Paul goes, I was the best. I was absolutely the best. And you're the best person you know, because you know all the little inner things that are going on. And so does Jesus. And we have this kind of stretch. I did this with the singles yesterday where you know you want to be right. And so you know what's right. But then you have that attitude when you wake up in the morning. And you kind of go, right's right here. Attitude bad. This is the wrong way. So what do? You try to go do something loving for either your roommate or your wife. You kind of go, hey, honey, I love you. Okay, good. Whew, I feel right again. And then you kind of get to work, and your work, you know, work comes at you like a fire hose, and it's just, and you have the bad attitude again. It's like, oh no. And now you're saying things you shouldn't say. Oh no. And now you're making comments, and then you're trying to drive. And of course, those drivers, right? It's not me, it's them. Okay, now we're thinking all sorts of evil, hateful things. And so all this stuff, and right is way over there. And so, okay, well, maybe if I share my faith, maybe if I have another quiet time, maybe if I read that book they told me to read, but I didn't. And we spend our whole life doing this dance. And no one even likes the music to this dance. And you wonder why spiritually you feel exhausted? Stop doing the dance. There is no favor line where I'm in God's favor. Oh, now I'm out of God's favor. I'm in God's favor. Now I'm out of God. You know what I mean? Yeah. Paul says we have to die to the law. Which law? The law that you decide, this is what makes me right. Instead of trusting that only in Jesus am I ever right. I have been crucified with Christ. It is I who no longer live, but Christ who lives in me. Waking up with saying, whose life am I going to live today? Now, this is important because this cross-shaped existence needs to be fueled and motivated by the right type of images. In order to make the shift, you have to see Jesus and see his calling clearly. Can we go to the next slide? I think for Paul, one of the moments, one of the stories that would have blown him away was the scene where Jesus washed his disciples' feet. You know, and I think it's especially important because the way John sets this up in John 13 is that he said Jesus knew that his hour had come. He knew that it was time and that the Father had placed everything under his feet. He was the most powerful, the most important, the most incredible person to ever exist. His time had come and all things had been placed under his feet. And what does he do? This is where Paul would pay attention. He gets up and then takes off his robes. Remember, Jesus came and walked on earth as a rabbi. People treated him like a teacher. That means he probably had the robes that signified, hey, of all these scrums that I have around me that I call apostles, these guys are not the teacher, I am. But Jesus took off that robe of distinction, that robe of honor and glory. He took that off, got down, well, actually, then took a towel, put it around his waist, filled up a bowl with water, and then went down and scrubbed the dirtiest feet you could ever imagine. He took off all the things that made him special and lowered himself down to scrub feet. What do we do when we're the most important people in the room? When you're the parent in the house? When you're the only disciple in a small group at school. When you're the boss. You're the lead worker. How do you use that authority? When you're in the marriage. When you have that sense that, hey, listen, I have a little bit of influence here. I have a little bit of control here. How do you use it? As disciples, we have a tendency to kind of grab onto that stuff and go, hey, I'm good. But the cross demands that we shed those things over and over again and think, how can I leverage what I have in to better the people around me? How can I be that example, that calling, that person that says, whatever makes me special, I take it off for your benefit? Because from God's perspective, everyone in this room is the most important person to any room you walk into. But what do you do with that knowledge? Well, I don't know, bro. I'm the only Christian at my job. Great. You're the most important person. What did Jesus do? He took off those robes of protection that separated me from you. He took those off and says, hey, how can I get involved? How can I help? How can I serve? It's a cross-shaped way of living. And I just am so, I'm convinced Paul would have been blown away by that because he craved those rabbinic titles. He loved them. And yet through Jesus' example, he learned to shed them, not only as a Jew, but then as a Jew appointed to go preach the word to the Gentiles, and then get to the point where he says, I've become all things to all people. People who do not have the law, I became like them. His whole life dedicated to the law, and now he's following Jesus. He's like, I live like people without the law. That means I go in and go, this is so wrong. Ew. Okay, well, we can go with that. Oh, this means a sacrifice by idols, but everyone here is, oh yes, it's so delicious. You know what I mean? Amazing. Amazing, amazing, amazing. But man, I think there's one other thing that would have blown him away, and this was the title that John gave him. John the Baptist. You know, when John came and announced that the kingdom was at hand, and then Jesus showed up on the scene, and John called out to all the people there and said, behold, the Lamb of God. To one who is so entrenched in Old Testament sacrifice, who would have understood what that meant full well, that there was going to be someone, not something, that was going to step in the way and remove all the sin. And then to hear John proclaim in front of his disciples, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. That might have been why Paul felt like he had to kill him some Christians. Because if that's true, everything I've devoted my life to is worthless. And yet, I just imagine Paul coming to grips that there was a lamb. I think we see this in the next slide. I think we see this in Revelation 5. I understand the church went through Revelations recently. Or someone did. Oh, a teaching day. See, never miss a teaching day, but the Bible kind of harps on that. You know, John introduces this idea of lamb. It's interesting that in the last book, they pick that back up. And I love the scene in Revelation 5, because it's a scene of incredible tension and insecurity and sadness. You know the story. I mean, you have chapter 4, which is the throne room of God, and you have these amazing living creatures. Everyone wonders, will my pet be in heaven? I don't know. But there are things so awesome that when John looked at him, he didn't know what to call him. He goes, and there were before me living creatures. They were animals, but not animals. I'm not sure what to call them. We'll just go with living creatures. But then in chapter 5, the tension is that the world is in a mess. It's out of sorts. It doesn't realize who its God is. It's not obedient to the throne room. And so there becomes a seal before all that would settle every dispute, every sin, every political power, everything that has gone wrong, every corruption that has introduced potholes to your roads, everything that has come into that makes everyone nervous when they listen to political rallies. There is a scroll. There is something that is coming that is going to address it all. And there it is before heaven. And then behold, someone goes, who is worthy to open the scroll? And John is there, and you can imagine, just like we are, going, yeah, who is worthy? Who can open the scroll? And there's a dramatic pause. And John's waiting. And then the Bible, it just says, and no one was found who is worthy to open the scroll. No one? Paul's response is understandable. Or not Paul. John's response is understandable. He starts to weep. If only we could crack the seal. If only there was someone who was worthy. Why is it that even though I try, I'm never good enough? And then the angel comes to John and goes, hey, man, knock it off. That's in the word behold. It's in the Greek. Trust me, I'm a doctor. He says, behold, for one who is worthy, look, the lion of the tribe of Judah, he is worthy to open the scroll because he has conquered. And then John starts to lift his eyes from out of his weeping hands, and he's expecting to see the lion of Judah. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. I know this church would just go. I have to reel you back in. Don't go there. I got to finish, you know? But yeah, I mean, that guy, woo! Yeah, I'm lifting my eyes up to see strength and power and honor and glory. And he looks up, and there before me was a lamb looking as if it has been slain. Wouldn't you rather have a lion? I've done too many funerals of members, family members, who have been shot down for no good reason. I've had too many counseling sessions where people have just left their spouses for no good reason at all. I've had too many times where I've attempted to do a really good thing and it just blow up in my face. And I felt that discouragement that says, why should I even try? Where's my lion? One roar would set it all right. You don't even have to break all the scrolls, all the seals. Just roar. Come on, Jesus, let it rip. Flex on them. Give them the elbow. Just one time. I would love for the lion to just roar. But that's not a cross-shaped way. Instead, he comes as a lamb. He could have come as a lion, but he comes as a lamb. And for Paul, when he realized that when John called him the Lamb of God, it must have cut him deep to the heart, because he had strived all of his life to have control over his life. I want all the circumstances to be exactly right. I want everything to go exactly like I've planned. Yeah, I've prayed, but I've planned this. This is how it has to go. He had fought for control. He had used all of his influence and all of his might to try to show, I am in a right standing with the Father. I am the example. He had tried to do everything in his own ability, only to realize that deep inside, he knew good and well he didn't have any control. We know good and well we don't have any control. You're fooling yourself if you think you could be the source of your own salvation, that if you just work hard enough, just do good enough, you're somehow going to turn your life completely right. It doesn't work that way. Your only hope is to quit looking for a lion when he came like a lamb, which means the church needs to be lamb-powered. It's got to be lamb-powered. And any struggle for power is a struggle of the devil. Because when you're lamb-powered, you're looking to get power out of the way. You're trying to strive for how can I serve? How can I lay my life down for the sake of yours? How can I be what I need to be so I can help you better? That doesn't mean tough conversations don't happen. It means tough conversations happen because there's two lambs coming together to work it out under the lamb. This is why I'm confident that even though right now the world is crazy and the church seems a little crazy too, I'm not worried about it. As long as we keep acting like lambs and we give up the worldly impulse to try to handle things like lions. It's lamb power. How did this impact Paul? Let's go to the end of Book of Acts. Let's go to the next slide, please. The Book of Acts ends in a kind of an abrupt way, but it's a perfect illustration of how much Paul bought into this. It says, for 2 whole years, Paul stayed there on his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. Paul's life, what we know of Paul, the last image we're given in Scripture is him under house arrest, chained to a Roman soldier. He's in a house that Rome didn't even provide for him. He had to come up with ways to rent that house, which was probably contributions from the fellow believers. And he was there with a Roman guard chained to him, not allowed to go out. And he's there, and he has every reason in the world to be upset, to be mad. How can I impact the world? How can I do what Jesus called me to do? All he could do was welcome anyone that came his way. All he could do was welcome anyone who came his way. You know, for those that have been shut in, for those that have been isolated, there is still the gospel that can go out from you. All you have to do is welcome all who came your way. He made the most of every Jew, made the most of every Gentile, made the most of every soldier. And this is how the whole book concludes. And he taught about the kingdom of God. He taught about an empire within an empire. Rome has its image of power. And here's Paul talking about, hey, listen, your guy is like a lion. Ooh, he's a big one. Oh, yeah, he's awesome. Yeah, I know I'm under his thing. But let me tell you, I follow a lamb that's way more powerful than that dude. He's going to come. You better get on the right side. You better start playing with some lamb power. You better start being cross-shaped because it's going to come. It's going to be made right. But not like you think. He taught about the kingdom of God and proclaimed Jesus as Christ, the one who loved me and gave himself up for me. For that guy, I will give it all away. I will give it all away. And because I live like that, the gospel could come out for me with all boldness and without hindrance. We serve a Jesus who has all the power in the world and looks to you and invites you in to say, hey, let's change this town. Let's start with your house. I'm investing myself in you to the point where I'm moving into your heart. Let's show them. Let's show them some lamb. And as you go to work, let's show them. Let's show them how to live powerfully without grasping for power. How to live differently without grasping for social media influence. How to be that example of it's not about me, it's all about him. And that invitation comes to you every week. When you, by practice, hold the gospel before you, and you break the bread. You break it, and this morning I would invite you not to just plop it in your mouth because it's bite size. I invite you to break it. Jesus, who is the glory of heaven, took off those robes of glory, took off everything that is worthy of being praised, came down and not only lived like you, but lived beneath you and gave his body, break it. And then hold the cup. Don't just shoot it back. Hold the cup. Because that is the promise. That this covers all my parked, reverse, and neutrals and self-propelledness. This covers every aspect of my life that is not in the right. And this promises me that because of this, I stand at that glorious place before the throne of heaven, in right standing, not by my power, but by the power of the Lamb. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this moment to remember. We thank you for our guide this morning and the Apostle Paul. God, I know that there is so many ways that we can look at his story, but I just am so grateful that in his life he had to learn to make shifts. And a shift out of being self-propelled and law-motivated to one that just trusts his entire life incredibly to you and to you alone. Jesus, I pray that as we break your body this morning, that there would be a part of our heart that would just be broken again in the most glorious way. You didn't have to give yourself for me, but you took off all the robes that should have set you apart from me, and you just moved in. Thank you. Thank you for loving me like that. And Jesus, as we take the cup, we ask that we would stand a little taller and a little brighter and a little freer, because we know that it's not about how good I'm doing or how bad I'm doing. I have to just be found in you. Let this cup remind us that the only thing to grasp for is for the Lamb who had been slain. And God, like Paul, help us to shed our own self-glory and our own self-pride and say, I just want to be like that. Thank you so much for this time. And God, please bless this church with impact, with your glory, with your power, with your influence, and let it be Lamb-powered from this day forward. We pray this all in your Son's name. Amen. Thank you.
Wow, thank you so much, guys, for such a powerful, powerful message, spirit-filled, and Kristin, for sharing your life and helping us realize that no matter what happens, God still, we still need to worship and praise God, no matter, even if things go in a different way, not our way, but God still lives. And Bill, for putting your heart as well, teaching us really how to shift back towards Christ, as he's given us his life, showing us how to live and showing us how to be close to him. And as usual, I'm not good in words, so I'll end up spoiling your powerful message. Let me just end it there. And guys, thank you so much for coming. And I hope you enjoyed the service. After this, just take your fellowship, whether you take it, you do it here, plus, but please keep your masks on as we're still fighting COVID. And the small cups that we're using for communion, please just throw it in the bins there when we go out. Please stand. And I hope you are ready to say, God, please send us so that we can serve you. And our brother Spoo will just do that for us in song.
To Mamina, where are to Mamina? To Mamina, where Baba, to Mamina, to Mamina, where Baba, to Mamina, to Mamina.
Amen. Church, you are dismissed. Have a great week.
Uba ufuna zomthuma.